Well, folks, welcome to the first event of the 2016 Sports Writers Festival. My name is Francis Leach. I'm one of the founders and the curator of the Sports Writers Festival, and on behalf of my colleagues Michael Edgley and Andy Kelly, it's our great pleasure and privilege to have you with us here tonight for the very first oration, the very first of its kind, and hopefully something that will become very much a part as a flag bearer for the Sports Writers Festival going into the future. Why a Sports Writers Festival? Well, I've always thought that sports writing had never been given its due in the wider culture, and that's why I decided that what we needed was a great sports writing festival, because great sports writing can take you inside that moment that, as sports fans, we all love. I've always found it funny. You hear those interviews after a game, and a player who's just won a premiership or a tennis player that's just won a title, and they say, "How do you feel?" And the answer invariably is, "Oh, I can't describe it, mate. I'm speechless." And that's perfectly okay. I mean, who expects our sports people to discover, as Van Morrison called it, the inarticulate speech of the heart at the moment of triumph and exhaustion? It seems a little silly to me that we expect them to be able to do that as well. And after all, as sports writers, that's our job. That's what we should be trying to do, because great sports writing can take you inside that moment. It can guide you through the heartbreak, and as a St Kilda fan, I know many of those moments, on the other side of any triumph. It can lead you through the missed opportunities, through the fortunate happenstance, through the aspirations and the exasperation that shape any sporting contest. And all of those things are very human and real experiences. And that's why I find great sports writing, like the material that's written by the man we'll hear from tonight, so compelling. At its best, a great sports writer can trace the contour of a game or a contest and the people that play those particular games and make it real on the page. And that's a real gift. In fact, the first book that I ever loved was a sports book. As a 10-year-old, I received a hardback edition of the late Max Walker's early classic, Tangles. And I loved that book so much. For a kid who was mad for Test cricket in 1978, camped out amongst the scorched paddocks and the housing commission's estates of Melbourne's northern suburbs out in Broadmeadows, that book became an escape route for me. I disappeared into its pages over and over again, and I can recount the stories of Max telling ripping yarns about growing up in his dad's pub in Tasmania, his time playing VFL footy and Test cricket. I mean, he played both VFL football and Test cricket, and as a 10-year-old kid in Broadmeadows, that was like the two things I wanted to do in the world, and he'd done both of them, and I was totally enthralled by the book. And in particular, it was Max's recollections of that Caribbean tour of 73-74 that mesmerised me. Like, I remember reading that stuff and being absolutely spellbound by those stories. For a kid who hadn't seen Brighton, let alone Barbados, it completely enchanted me as a cricket travelogue. It had that laconic vernacular, so when you read the book, you could almost hear Max talking it to you. And it still has a very strong place in my heart. In fact, all those years later, I was reading Marlon James's epic, magnificent Man Booker Prize-winning novel about the politics and intrigue of Jamaica in the 1970s, called A Brief History of Seven Killings. And Max's book came back to me because I felt like I knew a little of the terrain, because Max had taken me there as a kid and I had a sense of it. It came back to me. And that's the brilliance of that kind of writing. And part of it is knowing that sport is more than just about what's on the scoreboard, and that great writers embrace that. In Australia, nobody understands that particular value more than Martin Flanagan. As you know, Martin is a much-loved and revered columnist and writer for The Age and for Fairfax. And many of us await our copy of The Saturday Age for the pure pleasure of diving into one of his Saturday reflections. He's written around 13 or so books, including some of the ones that I love, The Call, which is a reimagining of the life of a mythical figure in Australian sport, the father of Australian rules football, Tom Wills, The Game in a Time of War, which explores a really important period of Australian history and the sporting experience of football during wartime. And for all those Western Bulldogs fans, and there are a few of you in the room today, long before the premiership arrived, his book Southern Sky, Western Oval explains more to you about what this year's triumph for the Dogs means for the people who waited so patiently for it, if you read it. He's written extensively also, as we know, about the relationship between Indigenous and non-Indigenous Australians, and does that better than anyone I know. His book, The Short Long Book, about the great Michael Long, was in fact, and Martin will tell you, a 13-year odyssey to get done that only just got across the line the day that it was going to the publishers. Quite literally, it was either press it or pulp it right down to the wire. But it explores the shared and contrasting experience of Indigenous and non-Indigenous life in this country at the intersection of where those two things meet most often. And maybe that's for a part of the thing about Australian football that makes it special, because it is usually on the football field. One thing about Martin is that he writes with a unique empathy. Now, for Martin, I think the sport that he writes about is as much a meeting place as it is a contest. Because from reading his work, you know that what he wants to know is who you are as much about what you play, because one walks side by side with the other. And it's Martin's gift for using sport as a path to something bigger and better than the game itself that makes his writing so special, however painful that journey might be. And if you read Martin's piece this year earlier on about Robert Murphy on the day that he was injured, it was a portent of what might be to come, something so bittersweet but so very real and so very human. And that's why his writing stands out. And in a world full of dark tidings, some of Martin's work, because it does reach out and touch us in that very human way, is a comfort and sustenance in a way that many of us need. So like all great sports writers, Martin reminds us that sport is about who we are as much about anything else. And his great gift to us often is to show us what that actually looks like. And tonight, with his oration, I think we're in for another experience of that. Can you please welcome him to the Sports Writers Festival, Martin Flanagan.
Thank you very much. Thanks all for coming. The title of my oration is Sport and Politics, the Adam Goods Case Reconsidered 1 year on, and I've dedicated it to someone I admire who's here tonight, Doug Vickers. In the 19th century, Karl Marx famously declared that religion was the opiate of the people. In the 21st century, it seems fair to ask, is sport the opiate of the people? Is sport the great distraction? The poet T.S. Eliot said, humankind cannot bear too much reality. I happen to believe that's true. Is sport now the principal means by which many of us insulate ourselves from reality? I think the answer to that is probably yes. Someone once said that sport is the most important thing in the world that doesn't matter. At one level, I agree. But at the same time, I never forget Nelson Mandela saying that sport has more power than governments to change social attitudes. That is true also. Furthermore, sport has the power to illuminate aspects of our society and our social past that otherwise remain hidden. My point is that sport, by which I mean popular sports that attract mass audiences, pivot on a series of paradoxes so that often in public arguments arising from sport, when others are absolute in their opinions, I find myself thinking, yes, but. People have suggested the theme I should address tonight is, should sport ever be political? I am tempted to reply, is sport ever not political? It's the story behind the creation of the modern Olympics. It's the story behind the 1936 Olympics in Hitler's Berlin. It's the story behind the state-sanctioned systematic doping instituted by Vladimir Putin's regime in Russia and the turmoil since that was discovered. Both the banning of Russian Olympians and Paralympians from the Rio Games and the subsequent hacking and release of the medical records of athletes who did compete. These are dark, disturbing stories. But the special magic of sport is that it also throws up bright, uplifting stories too. One of the best stories of my adult lifetime was the 1995 Rugby Union World Cup final between South Africa and New Zealand, played in South Africa just at the time when people on the political extremes in that country were on the verge of initiating a full-on civil war. That story is expertly told in Playing the Enemy by John Carlin, one of my half dozen favourite books on sport. It was in John Carlin's book that I found Mandela's quote that sport has more power than governments to change social attitudes. Who am I? Who is anyone among us to argue with Nelson Mandela on that score? But just as the theme of politics and sport is universal, it also has to be understood locally. Right now in Melbourne, as Eddie Maguire found out to his cost, you'd be a fool if you thought the views of women don't matter in footy debates. Personally, in seeking to balance the views of the two sexes, I like the Aboriginal idea of men's law and women's law. That is, there are two ways of seeing the world, two separate codes. They are not identical, but they have certain assumptions in common and need to coexist. In football, in Australian football, things get complicated since when I'm talking about football, I usually mean men's football. There is now also women's football. And men's football, throughout the length and breadth of the land, is hugely dependent upon the women working as volunteers around the clubs and not merely selling pies and cordial, as presidents, board members, commission members, secretaries, treasurers, supporters. It's a political fact that Australian football has to listen to the voices of women if it wants to have a future. In 2000, a Dutch journalist writing a book on the great sporting events of the world attended the AFL Grand Final and tracked me down to ask me a couple of questions. This was one of them, quote, "The average percentage of women at Premier League soccer matches in Europe is 13%. With your game, it is 48%. Why?" My answer is that women always seem to have been a big part of the game. The reason for this, I think, is that during the game's adolescence, the period between 1858 and 1880, Australian football was basically free entertainment in the parks. Among the crowd which circled these games, there was neither a members pavilion nor a ladies pavilion. No one could be prevented from attending since there were no fences. Everyone mixed as one. The best account of an early match was provided by an English journalist who merely signed himself as the Vagabond. He saw Carlton play Melbourne at the Carlton Ground in 1879. He describes the women he sees in the crowd, the lack of distinction between men and women, and between people of different religions and classes. The Vagabond judged the game to be unruly and violent. He ultimately asked if it was to the detriment of civilised values and concluded that it was, thereby giving expression to an idea which has never really gone away and regularly resurfaces, particularly during controversies about player behaviour. Social and political debates conducted through the medium of sport are like historical stews. Sport is a mask that people can hide behind and sound off, so that many of the views that are expressed contain prejudices against women, prejudices against men, class prejudices, racial prejudices, and prejudices against sport itself. One of the most radical and refreshing changes of our time has been young women flooding into sports that were previously regarded by some as the embodiment of male aggression and violence. And if anyone wants further evidence of continuing change in the culture of Australian football, it was surely Job Watson returning to Essendon after a year of exile and introspection in a cap with the word feminist written on it. Because sport is in everyone's face all the time in this culture, everyone thinks they know about it. Often people who don't like sport have opinions on sport which, when boiled down, come back to the fact that they don't like Sam Newman or Shane Warne or some other cartoon character from the world of tabloid media, or they don't like the fact that the endless shows on radio and television given to analysing sport serve to prevent people from considering everything else that's happening in the world. Well, yes, it's hard to argue with that. But as I said before, it is also true that sport can be socially illuminating. An example of this can be seen right now on the walls of the Ian Potter Gallery in Carlton. Put together by Melbourne artist Grant Hobson, the exhibition is about the Coonabba Football Club, the oldest surviving Aboriginal football club in Australia. Central to the exhibition are 11 black and white portraits taken in 1939 at Coonabba on South Australia's Eyre Peninsula as part of a study mounted by the Adelaide and Harvard universities. During the 1930s, there were intense discussions among academics, politicians, and civil servants in this country about what to do with Aboriginal people of mixed race, or what was then termed the half-caste problem. Proposed solutions included eugenics, or what was then called, quote, breeding out the colour. The 1939 photographs taken at Coonabba were like mug shots, the subjects being photographed from the front and side on. The notes with the portraits, which artist Grant Hobson and a Coonabba elder found in the archives of the Adelaide Museum, contained skull and facial measurements, plus descriptions of skin and eye colours. If you track the history of the ideas of racial superiority underlying the 1939 expedition back into the 19th century, you'll find they mutated with Darwin's theory of evolution to produce the notion that there was a missing link between apes and human beings. Aboriginal people were portrayed as the missing link. The strength and durability of this idea was displayed this year when a young woman, a Port Adelaide supporter, threw a banana at Eddie Betts. However, what the self-styled scientists from Harvard and Adelaide universities didn't appear to note when they visited Coonabba was that beneath their threadbare clothing, 9 of the 11 men they photographed were wearing Coonabba football guernseys. These were members of one of Coonabba's most successful teams ever, remembered to this day as the Coonabba Invincibles. Famous AFL names associated with the Coonabba Football Club are Burgoyne, Betts and Wanganine. Aaron Davey, Melbourne, and Alwyn Davey, Essendon, are grandsons of Coonabba's Dick Davey. Daniel Wells, North Melbourne and Collingwood, and Graham Johncock, Adelaide, are connected to Coonabba. Put simply, I would not have learned the Coonabba story if it were not for sport. There is so much about my country I wouldn't know if it were not for sport. There is so much about the world I would not know were it not for sport. I now want to move to the biggest political issue in Australian football in recent times, the Adam Goods saga of 2015. Before I do so, however, I want to make a few observations about contemporary politics. This is an age in which people are losing faith in democratic politics. This happened before in the 1930s, most disastrously in Germany. Our belief in democracy being able to produce suitable social ends is being questioned by people on both the left and the right. Into this state of political paralysis walks sport with its ready-made mass audience and its central place in the entertainment industry. Sport ideally is not about politics, but in this culture, sport provides one of the simplest and quickest ways of making a political point. What this gives rise to are debates about sport which are not really about sport, or are about sport, and so much more. Outside football, non-Aboriginal Australians, and by that I specifically mean non-Aboriginal Australians of all races, colours and creeds, display little active interest in Aboriginal Australia. We all know this to be true. It's our secret shame. It's in this atmosphere that Adam Goods gets called a monkey. It's in this atmosphere that he points to a 13-year-old girl, by his own account, reacting to the voice, not knowing she is 13, and she is marched from the stadium. After weeks of being booed, Goods does a war dance and throws an imaginary spear into the crowd. The main article I wrote about the Adam Goods affair was actually about Chris Lewis, the last Aboriginal player to be booed as vehemently, in fact more vehemently, than Goods was. In 1991, as West Coast built to its first ever premiership, Lewis established himself as one of the most promising young players in the competition. The following season, he copped full-on old-style racism and fought back literally. He got the reputation of being a, quote, dirty, unquote, player, but his side of the case, his defence, was being put. He became the game's outlaw. It's black outlaw. I defended him, the only journalist, as I recall, to do so, and we have maintained a relationship ever since. Chris Lewis has a warrior spirit, but he told me when he was 21 that he'd meet anyone halfway, and his life shows that he has been true to this belief. He has reason to be racist, but isn't. That, I thought, was the point of the article, but you wouldn't have known it from the responses I got. In fact, I don't remember a single response, and there were many, which dealt with what I thought the article was about. I was sent racist abuse about Chris Lewis, which was the same as the racist abuse he received in the early 1990s. I had expected that. It was the other responses I hadn't expected. For example, an Indian gentleman contacted me, demanding Adam Goods's mobile number. I'd written a story on the Indian gentleman's guru when she visited Australia some years earlier. He had been deeply impressed by the fact I had accurately reported what she said about controlling our lives with positive thinking. He now advised me that if he had Goods' number and the number of a senior figure in the Swans administration, he would advise them how to cure the problem with positive thinking. I didn't have Adam Goods' number, and I would not have handed it out without his permission. Under the circumstances, my chances of getting that permission would have been nil. In the wake of my failure to provide him with Adam Goods' number, the Indian gentleman contacted me again, saying that I should look deep into my heart and examine the racist feelings I harboured towards Aboriginal people. Why did the Indian gentleman deduce that I possessed racist feelings towards Aboriginal people? Because I had failed to give him Adam Goods' number so that he could solve the problem with positive thinking. What other reason could there be? Another reader, an articulate young man who was an avid Swans and Adam Goods fan, wrote in accusing me of trying to create a historical scenario in which Michael Long was the good guy and Adam Goods was the bad guy. I had tried to make the point that Adam Goods represented something different, something new, at least to non-Aboriginal Australians. I'd just spent 13 years trying to write a book with Michael Long, trying to see his story as he did and not as white fellas do. In race politics, things are always changing. I said Michael Long was like Martin Luther King, Adam Goods was more like Malcolm X. I didn't say Malcolm X was a bad guy, I didn't say Michael Long was a good guy. But between Martin Luther King and Malcolm X, there is or was a difference. And Adam Goods was different. I'd first noted it reading his essay in the AFL's official history, published in 2008. Goods said things Aboriginal people normally don't say to a non-Aboriginal audience. He called himself a half-caste. Aboriginal people, as a rule, never use the term half-caste. The Koori singer Archie Roach told me it made him feel like people were talking about cattle. In his 2008 essay, Goods also wrote about his formative years. If I learnt one thing from my 13 years trying to write a book with Michael Long, it was how big the stolen generation and the vast cultural divide it made for is in the families descended from the stolen. Goods' father is a white man. His mother is stolen generation who grew up with minimal knowledge of her culture. At school, the young Adam Goods copped it from white kids for being black and from black kids for being white. I know of no other famous Australian story which starts at that point, the narrator being someone who's an outsider in both worlds, Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal. As I understand the story of Adam Goods' life, his understanding of his Aboriginality starts after he gets to the Swans and falls under the influence of Michael O'Loughlin. During 2015, I didn't write about Adam Goods as if I knew him, because I didn't. We met once, but I came away with the feeling that I hadn't really met him. I think he'd say that too. We were polite with one another. I certainly don't believe I would have won Adam Goods' respect then or now by writing an article that implied I know him better than I do. That's why the article I wrote about the Goods affair was actually about Chris Lewis. I know Chris Lewis. I could discuss the matter with him. I read the article to him before I filed it. He struggled with it but agreed to let me send out his message another time. Chris Lewis, Aboriginal warrior, will meet anyone halfway. Isn't that what it's all about? Meeting others halfway. By now, the Indian gentleman was texting me daily saying, "You must denounce racism. You must denounce racism." I thought he was seriously misreading the cultural politics at play. The Adam Goods saga was my first confrontation with what I call Trumpism. A lot of people were making pious calls for the AFL to act. A characteristic of Trumpism is that old sources of cultural authority are suddenly without authority, limp, ineffective. To the people who became intent on booing Adam Goods no matter what, Gillon McLachlan, or what he is perceived as representing, was one of the reasons they were booing. To those same people, I was irrelevant if in fact they had any idea who I was. I write that the only people who could stop the booing were the players. The Indian gentleman went nuts. "They are only boys," he cried. No, the players are young men who make adult choices about risk and injury for all to see on the football field, and commensurate with the skill and bravery they show in doing so, they win the broad respect of their audience. Bulldogs captain Bob Murphy led the way, writing an article in The Age in which he called the boos being directed at Goods blows to the soul. I still wonder why more Indigenous players didn't stand up at the time. If Cyril Rioli, Sean Burgoyne and Bradley Hill had fronted a TV news camera and said to Hawthorn fans, quote, "We represent you, you represent us. Each time you boo Adam Goods, you're booing us too." If that had happened, and if as a bonus some of their white fellow teammates stood with them, like the Melbourne players stood with their Indigenous teammates at the time, then I reckon there would have been a different conversation in the crowd between those who were doing the booing and the many non-Aboriginal players, people of all races and backgrounds, who were opposed to it. I had some sympathy with those who said booing has always been part of the game. It has. The football codes go back to medieval street games and street theatre. They're about heroes and villains. They're about booing and cheering. A football stadium is not a church. Proceedings are not conducted in an attitude of reverence. So yes, I believe booing has always been part of the game. But I mean those words literally. Booing is part of the game, but there are moments when games cease to be games. In the 2000 grand final, Michael Long hit Melbourne player Troy Simmons with a hip and shoulder to the head and upper body, which knocked Simmons senseless. I had spent quite a bit of time that year helping a young man who had broken his spine in a skiing accident adjust to life in a wheelchair. When Michael Long collected Troy Simmons, I saw how that same accident could occur on the football field, and for a long moment feared that it had. The game ceased to be a game to me. I didn't watch any more. I didn't care who won. Michael Long is someone I have deep respect and affection for, but this was something I had to discuss with him in the course of doing our book together. Well, booing is part of the game, but the game can cease to be a game. And for me, the booing of Adam Goods did cease to be a game. It wasn't just Adam Goods who believed there was a racist element to the booing. Virtually the whole of Aboriginal Australia did, and lots of other peoples besides. Each week, more people felt the hurt being caused, but still the booing went on. The beautiful Australian game became the ugly Australian game. Essentially, what happened was that a debate or discussion we should be having as a nation but never do, the relationship between Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal Australia, had surfaced through the medium of the national game. Did Goods being Australian of the Year have anything to do with it? In my opinion, without doubt, as became clear when figures like Alan Jones and News Limited columnist Miranda Devine entered the fray, arguing, one, that the booing had nothing to do with Goods being Aboriginal, that two, they didn't like the way he played, but three, they didn't like the things he said as Australian of the Year when he spoke as an Aboriginal Australian. I found the debate around the Goods affair confused and confusing, a traffic jam of a debate. For example, the issue of war dances. A war dance is a war dance. As Goods said after he threw his imaginary spear, it's a challenge. The New Zealand haka is the great war dance of world sport. But there are very clear rules about the performance of the haka, as there was nearly an all-in brawl after the Irish rugby team decided to counter it by moving forward and standing inches from the faces of the All Blacks as they were delivering it. And the challenge of the haka is never issued to the crowd, always to the other team. When I wrote this during the Goods debate, a reader wrote in saying I was, therefore, anti-Goods. I would like to have asked the reader, have you ever seen serious crowd misbehaviour at a sporting event close up? I have, both attending soccer matches in Scotland and England in the late 1970s, when there was a spirit of barely controlled violence all around you, and on my first visit to the MCG in 1971 to see a one-day cricket match, when the place was awash with alcohol and police lost control of whole sections of the crowd. The journalist I thought who wrote best about the Goods affair, by which I mean with the greatest penetration and insight, was Stan Grant. When I met Stan Grant earlier this year at the Sydney Writers Festival, I said to him that the Goods affair was both simple and complex. He agreed. Grant's book, Talking to My Country, an extremely important Australian book in my view, explains the complexity of Grant's own journey as a man with both Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal heritage, and how the tensions of this has created in his life all came into focus for him during the Adam Goods saga. One of the things Stan Grant's book caused me to realise is that the Adam Goods affair wasn't merely about how non-Aboriginal Australians see Aboriginal Australians. It was also about how non-Aboriginal Australians were being called upon to see Aboriginal Australians as they'd never seen them before. Would I like to talk to Adam Goods? Of course. Have I got lots of questions to ask him? Maybe too many for a man walking a difficult and intensely personal path. But at this year's Sydney Writers' Festival, I heard that he had withdrawn permission for his biography, written by sports writer Malcolm Knox, to appear. My understanding is that he wants to retire from the public gaze, as is his right. I am sorry about what happened to Adam Goods, but I am in no doubt that he will be vindicated by history. In 25 years, probably less, he will be a huge figure in the history of the game. The AFL is routinely abused for having failed to eliminate racism. 2 years ago, at the launch of The Long Walk, I sat with Michael Long on a panel while a television journalist said to him that the Adam Goods affair was proof that he, Michael Long, had failed. You haven't abolished racism, he cried. This is a culture which provides huge public platforms for the likes of Donald Trump, Pauline Hanson, and Andrew Bolt. Does anyone seriously believe that half a dozen sports stadiums around Australia are somehow going to be rendered immune from their combined effect? The AFL can no more eliminate racism than it can end war. What the AFL can do is legislate for events which occur in its domain, have laws and enforce those laws, and thereby serve as a social model. Michael Long single-handedly revolutionised the cultural values of the game in 1993. That consensus held until the Goods Affair. We are now, historically speaking, entering new socio-political territory. Recently, San Francisco 49ers quarterback Colin Kaepernick chose to sit rather than stand during the US national anthem at a pre-season game in protest against the treatment of black people and people of colour in his country. While I was preparing this speech, I was asked, could that happen here? Yes. And if it doesn't happen here, something like it will happen in some other country around the world. I don't believe the human frailties and weaknesses on display in the Goods case are peculiar to any particular race or nationality. I take my faith from a remark made by the great Aboriginal leader Patrick Dodson. The struggle never ends. The reward is the people you meet along the way. I've tried to talk today about what happens when matters of national import arise through the medium of sport. I've also tried to frame the good saga in a different way and untangle some of the knots that were drawn so tightly at the time. Another aspect of the relationship between politics and sport is the way people seize upon sport as a means of acquiring money and power. This happens in dictatorships routinely, and by different means and to a lesser degree, it happens in democracies. A famous Australian comedy was written about it called Strictly Ballroom. But there is little amusing about world bodies like FIFA and the IOC, in which the most corrupt bodies and individuals have a history of flourishing shamelessly at the expense of the rest. I won't talk about that in detail because you have another journalist speaking at this conference who is eminently more qualified to do so, David Walsh, the man who pursued cyclist Lance Armstrong for doping. These are serious subjects which deserve the serious discussions a forum such as this can provide. But whatever scepticism I have about the IOC, I still believe in the Olympic ideal. I still support the idea of young athletes from all over the world meeting every 4 years. I am in awe of the Paralympics. Ultimately, for better or worse, sport reflects human nature. One of my favourite sports stories happened 100 years ago when the great armies in World War I ceased fighting on Christmas Day, met in no man's land, began kicking a can, maybe someone had a ball, and in the midst of unprecedented human carnage, soldiers from both armies began playing with one another. One of those who disapproved intensely was Adolf Hitler. Why? Because he was a homicidal maniac and he understood intuitively that men who played together were less likely to kill one another. And so we are confronted with a struggle. Sport is endlessly corruptible and there is a battle that has to be fought on that count. But sport, like hope, is constantly born anew, and it is a fact that good things grow from it. And so I conclude today by saying to you all, play on.
Thank you, Martin. Thank you for that oration and that insight. I'm just wondering, personally, having to write that, was that a challenge to as somebody who focuses on the very human aspects of sport, writing about people, than to take a bigger picture look at the terrain of the politics of sport?
Well, I think I have written on sport and politics before, but certainly the Goods case was, I personally found it traumatic. I felt like, you know, my country was being torn in two, and as I said, it was a traffic jam of a debate. And so when I was asked to do this, and I can't remember who came up with the idea of sport and politics, you or me, but when I began to explore it, it became an opportunity for me to try and work out exactly what I thought in a full way. And I hope that if I did that, Like, I don't expect anyone necessarily to agree with me, but at least I have the satisfaction of knowing what I think, and having worked out what I think, and my hope would be it might take some of the poison out of it.
It's interesting because you talk about the polarised nature of contemporary discussion, and sport is polarised. You're either for us or against us. You play on either team. And when cultural and political issues manifest in sport, often the nuances get lost. And I guess in some sense that's what happened with the Goods case.
Well, they get totally lost, and it happens almost immediately. And then you get polar positions. And if you take any position in the middle, the people at the edges see it as being see you as trying to put up a sham argument to protect one of the other or other of the parties. And as we move away from being a literate society into social media and communicating by 140 letters, then these debates become even more and more superficial. And when you get on the end of of abuse on the on Twitter, which has happened to me a few times, the abuse actually doesn't bother me. It's a bit like playing on the wing against Collingwood at Collingwood in the old days. You don't expect justice.
No one's ever called Twitter that before, but I think we're going to run with that.
You don't expect fairness. But what becomes apparent to you very quickly is that no one actually reads what you write.
Yeah.
That people simply react to what is said that you have written.
You talk a lot about your relationship with Indigenous Australia, and one of the great missing stories of Australian contemporary culture, well, history, is the fact that most urbanised Australians of non-Indigenous background have no experience of Indigenous culture.
Yep.
Has AFL football seems to have built a bridge towards that, but there's a long way to go. Have we made any ground through our sporting experience to understanding that culture?
I think it's indisputable that Australian football has, and the other sports, the NRL, but Australian football has made giant strides. I came to Melbourne in 1985. The racism in the crowds then was phenomenal. I mean, there's just no comparison between then and now. Now it's the odd comment. Then it was more the norm. So there has been an enormous change. But football has been a way for, people to get to know Aboriginal people. And I spent quite a bit of time at Melbourne, and the whole Liam Jarrah story, the effect that had on people like Nathan Jones, he was profoundly influenced by that, and so you get it at that level. But the whole Michael Long story, he gets racially abused in a game, he's not satisfied that the apology is sufficiently meaningful, he won't accept the apology. And the real politic of that was that the overwhelmingly white public backed a black man against a white institution. And when they backed him, and when it became apparent that that was the real politic of it, the AFL did this, just flipped 180 degrees. It went from having a culture that anything you said on the sports field was okay to suddenly being a national leader. And when people criticised the AFL, my question always is, well, who's doing it better? Because there's no people argue these things in absolute terms. There are no absolutes here. We're dealing with relativities.
Also, you talk about the institutional failure in our wider community, and how an organisation like the AFL, which does a lot of people are invested in the clubs and in the game, has become a surrogate for that. But it's not equipped to be able to deal in a way that we'd like it to be, to solve those social problems. But people expect it to.
Well, if you know, the expectations that are placed on sport now, because it is one of the few effective mediums for getting political messages across. So, I mean, I know of environmental groups, human rights groups, all sorts of groups that have breast cancer. This year we've had the Pride game. So it has become, everyone sees its power. But yeah, it can only go so far. And as I say, we're at this stage where we're in a state of political paralysis or disintegration, if what's happening in America is any guide. And so sport remains.
I think there's going to be more, not less.
So what does it say about, if you flip that over, what does it say about our communities and what's become of them? If sports become now the town square where these things are discussed, then it's inadequate to do so. It's not equipped to do so. It's not meant to do so. What has happened? What has become of our communities?
Well, my belief is that one of the central planks of political mythology over the past 50 years has been growth economics. And when these economies ceased to grow, people within those economies were prepared to accept inequality while they thought there was some chance of them getting ahead. When they don't think there's a chance of getting ahead, then the racial politics become fiercer and more intense. Gender politics become fiercer and more intense. Identity politics become fiercer and more intense. And that's all starting to manifest in sport.
Yeah, you still believe in it, as you said. I mean, you still believe in the ideal of sport and the things that we discuss and in my introduction that we love about it. So how do we protect it? How do we make sure that we shepherd that idealism to the next generation, that sport also serves that function in their lives for them?
I think there are plenty of people who are doing that. And, you know, the human capacity for hope and the human desire to believe, it just never goes away. And in this city, you know, in this part of Australia over the past 2 weeks, we've seen what in sporting terms was a miracle, which was the Dogs winning. And the feeling in this city has just been amazing, the feeling released by that. And that was essentially created by two men who had emotional intelligence and perceived this different way of doing things. And one of the really interesting things about the world at the moment is that, you know, you've got America in turmoil with Trump and what he represents. You've got Britain retreating from internationalism with Brexit. You've got Germany, you know, deeply divided on the question of refugees. So politically, things seem bleak. Yet there's been this series of maverick sports results around the world where entirely unexpected results have happened, like the Dogs here, the Sharks in the NRL, Leicester in the EPL, Cleveland in the basketball. And there just seems to be that, there are different forces at work, and maybe some of these are manifesting in sport at this time.
I was fascinated in your discussion talking about the difference between Chris Lewis and then Michael Long and then Adam Goods, and the using the comparison between Goods and Long and Malcolm X and Martin Luther King.
Yep.
As an outsider, Malcolm X was an outsider who was talking, in harsh terms, truth to power, whereas Malcolm X wanted, in a way, to walk side by side with the institutions.
Martin Luther King,
to walk side by side with the institutions to affect change to a certain point. Are we going to see another generation of young Indigenous footballers and who are going to be more strident in asserting their cultural identity, do you think? Do you see that Adam Goods will beget somebody else who will be even stronger in asserting their cultural identity?
I would not be at all surprised. So Michael Long never talks in terms of race politics. He never mentions it. Michael Long's always about we. Michael Long appeals to everyone in the same manner. There's no issue of race politics. He's of the same generation politically as he's as Patrick Dodson. They're not the same age, but Patrick Dodson and Michael Long are on the same Archie Roach. They're all on the same sort of wave. Goods is of a much later wave, and I think race politics are always changing. And it was actually you who asked me whether I thought the thing that's happening in America now with Colin Kaepernick, whether that would happen here in about 2 weeks after you mentioned it to me, Anthony Mundine raised it.
How would Australia cope with that? I mean, in America, in the States, and Brian's here, Curtis from The Ringer, and he's written about this in the past too, that there is a culture of strong African-American political dissent. Yeah. And it's not always a unified voice, but it is spoken. There is a long history of the struggle, whereas Indigenous culture, as it's seen within the wider white culture, it's still seen as a threat that needs to be met with hostility in a way that might be different elsewhere in the world. Will we cope with that if we have?
I don't think it is different anywhere else in the world. I think these are universal themes. They might have different faces, different names, but we're dealing with universal themes, but if it were to happen here, it will be a bitter and bruising debate. It will be bitter and bruising.
Do we need to have it, though? If it's on the sports field or not? Well,
for it not to happen, a lot of political things would have to happen off the field, which aren't going to happen. So
it's inevitable in a way?
Well, I think political activists will be saying to players, you know, you're out there for your people, you represent your people. So it just wouldn't surprise me.
We'll take some questions from the audience in a moment as well. If you've got a question for Martin about his oration, we'd love to hear from you. And just raise your hand in the air. But I think we're in a small space. We've got a microphone that we can share that we might be able to pass around. I want to speak, before we do that, about you personally. You could be a writer of... on any topic that you like. You could have written politics. You could have been a wonderful travel writer. There is anything you could do, but you stay with sport as the lifeblood of what you do. Yeah, do you ever have those moments of, because I have those moments of crisis where I think, oh, I should be doing something more serious with my life. Have you ever had that existential crisis about writing about sport?
Well, I think that I think where I differ from most sports writers is that most sports writers live in the world of sport. I actually live outside the world of sport. And I find the world outside sport pretty depressing. And I go to sport for holidays.
Which is what it's probably originally intended for.
Yeah. And so I go to sport to enjoy it. And when I go to sport, I don't sit in the press box. I don't want to get the group sort of journalist view. I sit on the fence. If I can't sit on the fence, I prefer to watch it on TV. I want to see the pace of the game. I want to feel the power of the collisions, because that's what excites in me, my appreciation of the skill and daring of the players, and that's where I get my words from. And that hasn't changed since I was a child. And so sport. When I was 11, 12, I was in a boarding school, unhappy, not relating to anyone much, and I got out in the sports field, and it was Burnie on the northwest coast of Tasmania, which was probably only 14,000 people, and there were five or six kids playing schoolboy football who played in the VFL AFL. One of them's Johnny Greening, a Collingwood legend, and Brent Croswell was coming along from Launceston and playing. And so I saw really good schoolboy footy, and it thrilled me. I saw beauty and grace, and I'd been grown up in this culture where hardly anyone said anything, and suddenly I'm out in the sports field and everyone's letting it all out. And I'm thinking, this is the most interesting place to be. And my brother and I always said we played football because it was the best place to watch from. And and so
you got a game at St Kilda any year doing that over the year.
So sports just been a sanity thing for me. And I've loved so many of the relationships and writing for footballers. You know, I've always got a lot of joy as a writer. Writing about people who can't express something and expressing it for them and then having them say to me, thank you, you got it for me. So I've always got a real kick out of that. And,
So people reveal themselves through their sporting experience. You get an insight into who they are.
Well, they certainly do. I mean, you cannot do it neutrally. You've got to unleash some other part of yourself to do it. And that's why someone like Robert Murphy is such an interesting human being, because he's been in that football club since he was 17, and he's now 33 or 34. So it's like going into a seminary, because the game requires a belief, and you have to have that belief, and to play. And he's got great stories about, you know, you have to find that belief, and you've got to deliver on that belief, and then you go home, and of course the beliefs. It's just a game. And that's one of the things that's so interesting about him. He's got that balance beautifully. Yeah.
The sport, as we know it now, the sport that we watch, is very professional. It's highly corporatised and in some way sanitised. Can you still find those things that give you sustenance in sport from watching, say, professional AFL football or test cricket or the sports that you grew up loving?
Well, I can. I mean, my test of a great sports encounter contest, it's pure and simple. Is it transcendent? Does it make me forget everything that's going on in the world? Does it make me forget about ISIS? Does it make me forget about Donald Trump? Does it make me forget about Syria, Aleppo? If when that's happening, I know I'm watching great sport. And it's like I've done an article on, I do two columns a week, one's on footy, one's on sport and culture, but I've done one on this idiot Liberal senator who wants to sell blue poles. But I was in New York 3 months ago and I saw one of Jackson Pollock's great paintings, which has got a name like 1 number 31, 1950. And just realising it was a masterpiece and just being drawn into it. And it's exactly the same as a great sports contest for me. I just get drawn in and I forget everything else. And that's when I know I'm in the presence of a masterpiece.
And sometimes, well, a lot of the time when we're reading your work, that's how we feel as well, Martin.
Thank you very much for your oration.
We're going to go to the audience now. If you've got a question for Martin, we've got a roving mic. Just introduce yourself and we can...
My name's Edward Kemp. I'm a fellow Tasmanian from Martin, but I'm from the other end of the island.
Yes, you are. I know about you.
I wrote some notes while I was listening and I really appreciate you coming and talking to us. Racism, corruption, meeting halfway, polarising. But the thing that amazes me about sport is that sport can bring people together but can also tear people apart. And I saw that firsthand on Wednesday night at a local basketball club where two factions of a community got together and eventually decided to work their problems out. But the article you wrote about Chris Lewis was amazing for me because I know Chris and played football over in WA at the same club that he grew up in at Claremont.
Oh, yeah.
And
yeah.
So firsthand, and I was a very average player, let me tell you, but the point was that I saw the racism that was delivered to younger Aboriginal guys that I played in and around, which I thought as a kid from Tassie was just extraordinary.
Yep.
And it really changed my view on a whole range of things. Just that one article, it was really powerful. My question, though, is if you look at where we are now and you look at what giant strides the AFL has made in bringing this issue to a head, not to a head, but bring it down to the open, because I think the most famous football image ever is Winmar at Victoria Park. And, I mean, Martin, how do you think it's going to change moving forward, and I think Francis asked the question around the next generation or the generation after that. I'm not talking about the players. I'm actually talking about the people who are watching, because I don't think I've ever heard a racist remark in 20 years of living here and going to the AFL football.
Yeah. Well, I as I said when I quoted that quote from Patrick Dodson, he said the struggle never ends. That's what I think. And the destabilising things that are happening around the world, they will impact on us. And anything could happen. Be ready for anything. But your story about the basketball club, all the human dramas, they're all there in sport. You'll find them. That's why Strictly Ballroom's a great movie. You know, it's all there.
I'd also like to thank you, Martin, for the oration tonight and agree with Francis. It's your columns I love looking forward to each weekend.
Thank you very much.
I'd like to ask you, as a lifelong Melbourne supporter, obviously the Liam Jarrah thing was really damaging. How damaging has it been long term, both to him and to the footballers who were coming out of UNMU and places like that?
The Liam Jarrah story, the Liam Jarrah story will be talked about in 20 years, 40 years, 50 years.
Martin, for those, there are people in this audience who might know a little bit about it. Tell a little bit about who Liam Jarrah is.
The Liam Jarrah story is like no other story in Australian football, but possibly like no other story in world sport. He comes to Melbourne as an initiated Warlpiri man. Now, there's a lot of people who identify as Aboriginal Australia who are not initiated, but so that makes him a very unusual person. He comes, no one is sure whether he can speak English when he arrives. He speaks three Aboriginal languages. In fact, he could speak English, but he didn't. He didn't if he didn't have to. He first goes to Collingwood. They want to test his athleticism, and they put him on a running machine. He leapt off because he thought the earth had moved. He played a game in the VFL reserves for Collingwood, and the boys all go down to Port Phillip Bay for their dip the next morning, and he's sitting in the car shivering, and they go, "Come on, Liam, get in. He's a desert man. His whole culture over thousands and thousands and thousands of years is about the desert." The bloke who looked after him here said he may have seen the sea. He certainly had never been in it. And And then, of course, while Liam was there, they had the Demons also had Ozzie Wanamiri from the TV Islands. And I rang up once and I said, could I do a story with the two of them? And they said, what about? And I said, about their culture. Anyway, they had a very good Indigenous liaison fellow there at that time, Ian Flack. He went and talked to them, he came back and he said, they don't have the same culture. You know, Aussie's favourite food was turtle and you know, tropical fish. Liam had never eaten fish. Liam's was kangaroo and... So they were, you know, they didn't talk culture, they talked footy. So then Melbourne took Liam and he was a really exciting player and he won the 2012, I think it was, AFL Mark of the Year. But at the same time, things were happening in his home community and eventually there was effectively a civil war in his community. And his tragedy, which was of Shakespearean proportions, was that his mother's family were on one side of the war and his father's family were on the other. And under Aboriginal law, you are obliged to get involved. And he strove to stay out. And he stayed out for about 18 months or so. And then one night in Alice Springs, it all caught up with him and he was charged with assaulting a bloke with a machete. And I mean, his story, his story is just, you know, it's just one giant drama. I remember I wrote at the time, I said, he's the Albert Namatjira of Australian football. And anyway, his life hasn't, I haven't seen him and I haven't spoken to him. I've spoken to people who have. I don't know how he views it. And I think you've got to be very careful about projecting your preconceptions. But Melbourne may have failed in some respects, but they got a hell of a lot right. And they went to enormous lengths to do that. And... And of course, the tragedy is, or the question is, will AFL clubs give kids from remote communities that chance again? Because if they don't, then the game ceases to be, the game's claim to be the Australian game is diminished by that amount. But having said all that, like AFL clubs are still way ahead of other Australian institutions. Sean Burgoyne for Hawthorne, the Aboriginal player, he's a very smart young man and he's a very political young man. Now, if Sean Burgoyne's not happy with something happening at Hawthorne, you can bet Cyril Rioli's not going to be happy. So there has to be a dialogue within that club between those people and they have to talk about things that otherwise aren't spoken about. So that's why it's that old story that, you know, the winning mechanism, it always... leaps boundaries, leaps cultural, racial boundaries. It always has, all around the world.
Thank you for your questioning. One other aspect of that I think is interesting is that Liam Jarrett was celebrated when he was playing as this extraordinary story, almost as if he'd come from the moon and landed in white Australia. But when his culture came calling, he was then portrayed as the outsider, the Aboriginal kid who typically got into trouble. Did we fail ourselves by not trying to understand more deeply his duty and responsibility? Was that a missed opportunity for urbanised middle-class Australians who think they want to know about Aboriginal culture didn't bother finding out why he found himself in the circumstance he did? Were we not prepared to meet him halfway in that regard, the way that Chris Lewis would have said?
I'm not sure that our understanding could have extricated him from the dilemma he was in.
No, I don't think that could have happened, but we could have at least maybe learned a little bit more about what life is like for him.
That is constantly the case. That is constantly the case. Another good Liam Jarrah story. When he's playing for Melbourne, his second game at Etihad, and Melbourne played in, I don't know what the name of the rooms are, but they played in that room in his first game. They played Essendon. So they're in that room and Essendon are in that room. And the next week they played Carlton and Carlton were in that room and Melbourne were in that room and he wasn't there and they panicked and they get on the phone, the mobile, And they ring him and he answers and they said, Liam, where are you? He said, in the rooms, but Carlton's here. and at the end of his first year, because he was this sensation, the Deadlies at the Indigenous Awards, they rang at the Sydney Opera House, they rang him up and asked him to come up and present one, and he didn't know where the Sydney Opera House was. How many people in Australia would not know that?
Well. Extraordinary life. Are there any more questions for Martin? We've got a couple here over here. Do we know how Liam is now? Is he?
Well, he's been in jail a couple of times. He's had.
So he's still living with the struggles.
I'm not sure where he's living, but he's had he had big problems with his relationships with women. Yeah, a very tangled story.
Hi, Martin. I'm Dylan, and I'm a Richmond supporter, so I don't know where you get this idea that people get joy and pleasure out of watching sport. But anyway, to sort of go, I don't really focus on the Adam Goods thing, but you mentioned how when sport has not been when sport has not been politics, when has it never not been?
Yeah.
Do you think politics has now been covered more like sport? I mean, if you have a look at the way elections are analysed, you have a look at the way question time's organised, even have a look at the infographics on election coverage, it looks like something ESPN's produced, not CNN's produced. So in the way that sport is analysed, I mean, politics is analysed like sport, do you think that sort of contributes to all the sort of, you know, nasty Trumpisms and, you know, the stuff that people just focus on rather than talking about the ideas and policy?
Well, I remember Brendan Gale, your CEO, said to me, not at the last federal election, but the federal election before, that there were now 800 registered journalists covering the AFL that year, and there were 200 registered journalists covering the federal election of that year. So that tells you something about where the media motor is. Do I think that politics is being covered more like sport? Yes, sport provides politics with cheap metaphors. Mm-hmm. Having seen the second presidential debate in the US, I mean that was one of the ugliest, most gruesome, grotesque public discussions I've ever seen. We could be going in that direction.
A bit like watching Richmond. Sorry, Dil.
Any other questions?
Hi, Martin. And I'm Anant and I'm from India. Yes. And I'm living here in Melbourne. Just learning a lot about AFL, but this is my first experience of being at Sports Writers Festival.
Yep.
I'm a cricket freelance writer who writes for a lot of Indian cricket websites. So I have some questions, and your oration was fantastic, that it was enlightening in a way that now I could see so much of politics running in cricket around the world. Different races of politics as well.
Yep.
Financial, some with race, with region.
Yep.
You can go on and on.
Yep.
It put a lot of questions in me, and I just wanted to ask a couple of them. One which is currently happening between India and Pakistan, because of politics and the warfare that's happening in the border.
Yep.
Cricket has not happened between these two countries, Test cricket especially, since 2007.
Yep.
So it's kind of stalled the sport, and I love the last two words of your oration which said play on.
Yep.
But it's not happening. I had a lot of discussions on this with friends and fellow writers in India. I've always tried to see which is of bigger value. Is it the life that is being lost when there's war everywhere, or is it sport that can actually be the healer between two countries who are at war?
Yeah, well, I think that's a really important question, and I think it's a really important issue. I was involved in the what was called the AFL peace team. It was half Israeli, half Palestinian. And I went to Israel and met the Palestinians and met the Israelis, and the team was organised incredibly, like everything was even. Like there were two captains, two coaches, everything was done evenly. And I was in Jerusalem the night when they had this private session where the Israelis and the Palestinians actually sat down and spoke about what was going on. And when they came out, I was amazed to learn that it was the first time most of them, most of the Israelis had ever spoken to a Palestinian, and most of the Palestinians had ever spoken to an Israeli. Now, in that situation, all those two sides know of one another is what the media tells them. And in this country, on Aboriginal issues or race issues, and we're a relatively benign country, but we've got some real poisonous voices, and we've got some really powerful poisonous voices. So when that team came out here, there are many, many, many great stories about the peace team, the amazing stories. But the Palestinian community didn't accept them. And the Palestinian community believed that it was merely Israeli propaganda. And I could see their argument. I understood their argument. But temperamentally, I am just drawn to the idea that it is better to try and create a bond and extend the hand than it is to not do so. So I'm temperamentally, that's how I go. And we're of Irish descent, and the Civil War in Ireland had a big effect on me. And I remember one of the people who was involved in the peace process in Northern Ireland, he said to me, in the end, there is no alternative to dialogue. And so insofar as sport can facilitate that, I support it. But I understand the political arguments around it.
Yeah, even I would want to see world number one and number two test teams play against each other. Yeah. Nothing like it. There's a second question that I wanted to ask. As much as you put out the Nelson Mandela statement, which was fantastic about how much sport can do more than what the governments can, in that country, South Africa, currently we have transformational targets that rugby and cricket teams have to follow, which means that we have what, five players who are back who should be part of the 11. And in fact, that had actually impacted the game itself. If you take the World Cup semi-final and AB de Villiers, by his own admission, wanted to play Kyle Abbott, but because he had got a call from Cricket South Africa saying that you need to follow this, and hence he had to pick Vernon Philander, and he was in a situation where he knew both of the players were his own teammates, but still he was feeling that he was doing something which is not right. So what do you think about sports having reservations?
Well, I think it's really important at a conference like this, but in life in general, not to make out that you know more than you do, and I'm talking about myself here. This is a question I have not thought seriously about, and so therefore I don't have an informed view to put to you on that.
I do have a bit of an informed view, having spent some time in South Africa and with Francis Green, who's in the audience tonight, having made a little film about South African township football. And what I will say to you about positive discrimination is it's about institutional change. So, for instance, in that situation, South African rugby and South African cricket are vestiges of white institutional power in that country traditionally. And for those institutions to change, they need to be incentivised to do so. And so it does seem rough. But if you've lived in a society where the institutional power was heavily invested and brutally invested in one part of the community, to actually change the structure of the cricket structure and also the rugby structure, it needed to know that it needed to invest in black and coloured communities to find players and to include them in the team, because it wasn't going to do it on its own. And what it would have been a retreat into white South Africa. Those institutions would remain. And rugby still has to fight that very strongly. I think South African rugby still lives with that problem, is that it is still somehow becomes almost like a safe haven for old white culture. And I understand your question and the vexed problems and the ethical problems it poses for the captain on the day, but the bigger question is that institution, how do you change it? You have to maybe use a form of positive discrimination in order to make the institution understand that it needs to change. And it's a long and difficult process in South Africa, a difficult a road to walk, but it wasn't going to happen on its own. That's the dream anyway. That's the hope. Thank you for your questions. I think we've got a couple more questions, hands in the air.
But I've got the microphone.
So well, you're in charge. You've got the conch.
I've got a question about racism in the AFL. And I was really glad to hear you talk about the confusion of the debate with Adam Goods, because it was just so deeply confusing. You know, it was like gridlock. What I found interesting was when you talk to people who didn't believe it was about racism, they would say, well, if it was racist, then all black players would be booed. And I didn't have a ready response. And so I guess it's a two-part question. One is why you think some are booed and not others. And two, my theory, which I wouldn't mind stress testing, my theory is that that white society has a notion of an acceptable Indigenous an acceptable Indigenous player. And so you made the divide between Malcolm X and Martin Luther King, but essentially the players that you talked about, Nicky Minmar, Michael Long, Chris Lewis, Adam Goods, are really, really strong personalities. So Michael Long, the night after he won his Norm Smith medal, he came to the microphone at the club function, approached the microphone and said, geez, I played well. Like that's, in a culture so averse in the debasement of the individual, for a white person to say that, that's a controversial statement. For a black man to say that, and it was a long time ago. So those four players are really, they go outside of a white, to my theory is that they go outside of a white perception of what we want our Indigenous players to be: polite, grateful, well-mannered, inarticulate. And then we get these players that aren't that, and that's where we smack them down.
The big difference between Adam Goods and all the other people you've named is that he was Australian of the Year. And I think making a footballer of any race Australian of the Year is fraught with danger, because if you make a cricketer Australian of the Year, he plays cricket for Australia. But you make Dane Swan Australian of the Year.
Wow, that'd be an interesting day.
He plays for Collingwood, and when he plays Carlton, you know, they don't like him. So the whole thing was fraught with danger from the start. But Goods is a much more explicitly political person, he expresses that. And Michael Long is a political person, but you don't see it.
But not accepting an apology, like that's a really... That's not political language, but that's a very...
Oh, no, he's strong. Right. Oh, yeah, he's strong. But Neville Jetta from Melbourne, he's strong. I reckon Eddie Betts is strong. But Goods was of a different type. And Goods, he's on this journey to discover what it means, what his Aboriginality means. That's a huge journey for him to go on. And he saw the John Pilger film Utopia about the remote Aboriginal community. I think it shocked him. And then he thought that was the game changer. That film was the game changer. Once Australia saw that film, everything would change. And then what shocked him even more was that no one was interested. It didn't even get a mention in the papers. And that's when he said he was embarrassed to be Australian. And from that moment, that was an enormous change in the whole psychodrama.
But why do you think some players are booed and not others?
Well, who was the last player booed in the sustained manner that Goods was? It's Chris Lewis. Players get booed, you know, because someone gets a clip under the ear behind the player or something, but this was much bigger than that.
We've got a few more questions before we close.
G'day, Martin. My name's David.
We've met.
At one of the Footy Almanac launches.
David Wilson.
That's right.
Yeah.
So the question to you, thanks very much for your talk. The question is about meaning in sport and in politics. So in sport, we have this meaning, we belief to a club, we invest in that, or the sport itself. And in politics, perhaps less people are members now of political parties than I think membership's declining over time. So where do you see people's belief and kind of their meaning in life directed politically as opposed to in a sporting sense?
Politically? Well, politically, we're in a period of enormous flux, just enormous. You know, anything could happen. If Turnbull gets torn down, we're going to have a completely different political landscape because he's really in the centre compared to the other elements at work. And Tony Abbott, who has announced in London that he thinks he'll be Prime Minister again and then endorsed Donald Trump, showed his impeccable judgment as Trump's going down in flames. Abbott's said he finds him reasonable. And he's planning a comeback. Our politics, I think the world, to me, it's like we have lived with the last half of the 20th century. We have lived with its cultural and political legacy. And just as you can say that, you can say the 20th century started in 1914. Well, it's like suddenly that 20th century is being thrown in the air and pieces are landing all over the place and in very unusual ways. And I've done a column for tomorrow and it's on this theme, you know, that at a time when you've got Donald Trump explaining his 2005 remarks to Billy Bush as locker room banter. And I've said not everyone in the locker room talks like Donald Trump. And I've juxtaposed it with Job Watson, who has clearly is a young man who's been on a deeply personal journey and has had enormous weights on him. And he's come back, he's ready to play, and he's wearing a cap with feminist written on it. I think that was quite an historic event. So I got no idea where it's going, but it's all about trying to stay sane.
And I think sport plays a huge role in people's lives to do that. Yvette, you've got a question.
That was interesting. That was where my question was. How do we maintain our thinking in the with the pressure coming to not think, with the Trump, through Pauline Hanson, through that sort of way of viewing the world, that reason, discussion, analysis, that's not part of it. So just with the thought of how do we maintain our sanity in thinking through that
For me, I'm 60, going on 62. For me, at this point in my life, the biggest question is, how do you remain aware of all that is happening in the world and still lead a useful and productive life? I think that's one of the great questions. And certainly sport helps me. Like what happened in Melbourne over these past 2 weeks was just undeniably, objectively fabulous.
And we need more of that in our lives because there's so much of the other. Oh,
thank you. My name's Luke. I think I'm the only person here who's not a journalist or a writer of some description. But I'm here with my son, and he wants to be, so there you go. Enjoy your columns, enjoyed your oration. Taking someone from overseas to an Aussie Rules football match, I use the word Aussie Rules because I found the term industry, which has been...
Ugh, gross.
...uttered, it slipped into the vernacular... Can you pinpoint it, please, at all, Francis, when it actually became accepted
lexicon? When the coaches and the CEO started using it, because I think the corporatisation of the football culture across the road, headquarters is just behind us here, started. It operates like a corporation.
They think they are
a corporation. They don't deliver a dividend to anyone other than themselves. But
should it appear off the back pages and into the centre pages?
I was a media manager at one of the football clubs, I would have a swear jar every time my CEO, my football manager, said it's a brutal industry, or uses the industry word rather than talking about their club and it being a game, because it's ridiculous.
One of the things that makes Luke Beveridge so interesting is he came from outside the industry.
That's right.
Yeah.
He didn't come up through it, because the ones who come up through it, the AFL's, it's a bureaucracy, and it's got its own bureaucratic language, and its own bureaucratic way of thinking. Like, you know, what Beveridge did taking Caleb Daniel. No one else would take him because the bureaucracy said he was too small. Mm. And Beveridge said, "Can he play?" And they say, "Yeah, he can play." He said, "Well, we'll have him."
Well, it's good. And I suppose my question goes back to those traditions about things we should celebrate. One of the things about taking an overseas person to the football, you know, who are those guys who are running around in the middle? It's the little league, you know, like... There's some things that are uniquely Australian, running through the banner and things like that. They're uniquely Australian about the game. In the growing corporatisation and all that, the draft and all the stuff that is homogenising sport and coverage, what things do you think that we can export still about the game which are really Australian? You talked about women.
Which we can export.
Export Australian values or celebrate. Is there something Australian that we could export in the sense of making it acceptable? We celebrate it. We can export it, I suppose. But what things in the game... You said women, which Australian is... Aussie Rules is uniquely Australian and it has uniquely high women followage. So what things can we still celebrate in the game that are uniquely Australian?
Well, just a couple of things. Women's football, the exhibition match that was played... during the bye round, which surprised so many people as to how fast it was and how hard it was. And one of my brothers said to me, wouldn't it be a profound irony? Because I think it's a great game and I love the way the women play it. And he said, wouldn't it be a profound irony if women's AFL ends up being an international sport and men's AFL isn't? but to go to your other point, there's a gentleman here today from LA, the journalist from LA.
Yeah, Brian Curtis.
Brian Curtis. Because one of the great characters of the game is this black American AFL nut who lives in LA called Gil Griffin. And he's an amazing story that's too long to tell here, but he loves Australia. He feels his soul is Australian. He's a mad Freo supporter. Gets over here as often as he can, goes to as many games. You can't tell him anything he doesn't know. And he is in anguish about how the AFL keeps trying to Americanise the game. And he says, don't you understand that its Australianness is what makes it great? And if I took over the AFL tomorrow, the first thing I'd do would be to stop the gravy train where about a dozen of them every year go to the Super Bowl and come back with five more bad ideas. I'll tell you a good question would be, why did they stop doing the grand final parade through the city and from the top of the city to the MCG? Now, I don't know the answer, but I think it's because they then make the MCG into a commercial precinct and so that when people get there, they... Yeah, so, absolutely. No, but,
We've got a time for maybe one or two more questions. We've got three questions to go, so we'll come down to this gentleman here and... because I think they're going to kick us out soon, but it's been fun.
Yeah, my name is Michael Berman. I'm from Sydney, and AFL is a bit foreign to me. But I'm raising the matter of Peter Norman. He was an athlete from Victoria who got a silver medal in the 200 in 68, I think, at Mexico. Yeah. And as a result of wearing the badge that... No, the two coloured athletes did the Black Power salute, and they were wearing a badge, and he wore a badge too, and he was ostracised when he came back to Australia, and he's from Melbourne, I believe.
He certainly
is. When he died this year, those two athletes came and they're the ones who were carrying his coffin.
That's true.
So, you're talking of racism. You know, that's international.
Francis actually had a stronger connection to him than I did, but his funeral, it was like Chariots of Fire. It was like the start of Chariots of Fire. It was this phenomenal moment where those two black American athletes at the Williamstown Town Hall carried out his coffin. And I've said in the paper that there should be some memorial to Peter Norman at the MCG.
Peter's story was one. He paid a heavy price for his act of conscience. So Peter was a Salvation Army man. He grew up in the church, had a very strong sense of moral compass, unhesitatingly had that moment. If you spoke to him, and I did speak to him, I did get to know him before he died, that he knew that that was a moment of decision for him when Tommy and John ran beside him and they asked him, would he be involved? He didn't hesitate to say yes, but he knew it would come at an enormous price. He was ostracised by Australian athletics. He ran 8 times qualifying for the 200 metres for the Munich Olympic Games, but they refused to select him. He was ostracised from the Australian Olympic movement right up until the Sydney 2000 Olympic Games, where he did attend the Games, but he wasn't invited by the Australian Olympic movement. He was invited by Michael Green, the US 400 metre runner, who invited him as a guest and a hero of the US track and field team. So he never really did reach a rapprochement until very late in his life with Australian athletics. But it does talk a lot about that Australia then and how it was dealt with. And it made his life pretty tough, as it did for Tommy and John. But I'd like to think that in this day and age there'd be a much stronger public reaction in support of what he did. I think that was a year after the referendum to allow Indigenous people the right to vote and actually count them as citizens. We still had a very, very long way to go in terms of our understanding of race relations. And while we haven't come anywhere near far enough, I think if Peter Norman were to be involved in the similar protest now, there would still be a division in the community, but there'd be an army of people, many of them in the room, that would stand up for him.
His name's only going to get bigger.
Yeah. Oh. He was a lovely man. We've got one more question
here. Yeah, thanks. The documentary on Peter Norman was brilliant.
Yeah, Salute, if you want to check it out. Yeah.
I think about sports heroes, and I think Jesse Owens, Carl Lewis, Usain Bolt, Pelé, Michael Jordan, Tiger Woods, Muhammad Ali, all pretty much the best in their field, all black. And then in Australian rules, Graham Farmer, Barry Cable, the Riolis, etc., there's been some absolutely stunningly brilliant footballers who are black as well. I think white people can handle black heroes or superheroes so long as they toe the line. So long as they don't get uppity, and I think so long as they act white, and that's, I think, why people react so strongly against Adam Goods. I took on arguing with trolls on Facebook, but, you know, never got anywhere. But are black athletes failing their race by not taking a political stance? Is it enough for them just to play, or should they also make a stand of some sort? Because the stands have been powerful, as you say, Winmar's gesture, et cetera,
are I'm not going to say they should. I mean, that's an individual conscience thing. But these are the arguments in play.
It's a difficult one because each individual needs to be able to walk their own path. And if we're going to expect young Indigenous athletes to take on and represent those issues, then why should non-Indigenous athletes do the same within in the wider community on a whole range of issues? You have to want to do it and you have to believe it and you have to feel it. We shouldn't settle other people with the burden of solving our problems. They have to be empowered to do it because it comes from in here. Have we got a question?
Martin and Francis, I flew over from Adelaide today to hear you speak and I'm really glad I did.
Oh, welcome. We're thrilled to hear.
Just a question about sports writing more generally in Australia. You talked about how you sort of, as a journalist, you operate outside of the bubble. You don't sit in the press box. You talk about sport in the context of broader life. Do you have any sense of why there aren't more journalists in Australia that do that? I know I read stuff that Brian has written, that's written in the United States and in the UK, for instance, where there is a lot more sports writing about the broader meaning of sport. But we don't see a lot of it in Australia. I know I work for a tabloid newspaper and there's almost none of it. Do you have any sense of why and whether or not we're worse off for it?
Well, certainly when I started, there was a war to get, there were always people, well, there'd be people trying to rewrite you and you'd have to fight the war. And I was lucky in that I'd done quite a bit before I got into journalism. I'd done a law degree and I'd worked in a prison. I'd spent a few years wandering the world. And by the time I got into it, I knew who I was. And I also knew what I wanted to do. And I was prepared. I was prepared to fight for that. And I, like some people say to me, I've had a fortunate journalistic career, but I get a little bit offended by that because I never went for money. I never went for foreign posts. I wanted control of what I wrote. I wanted what I wrote to be published as I wrote it. And I fought for that, and I got it, and I got it because I had an audience, and my audience came with me, and so that's one of the reasons why I love Melbourne, because the audience here, there was an audience here for it. But at the sports writing tradition, when I was younger, it was there wasn't very much good sports writing at all when I was a kid. And I remember I went to Britain in the 70s and one of the things I loved about their sports writing was that their sports writers wrote as spectators. They didn't make out they were players. I loved that because to me in non-fiction writing, the relationship between the writer and the subject and knowing exactly where that relationship stands, that's critical to the whole undertaking. That's why the Michael Long book took 13 years. But so that was in Britain. I saw really good sports writing of that sort. And then in America, I personally loved the American generation of sports writers like Hemingway and bullfighting and Ring Lardner, and probably the best piece of writing I've ever read on sport was by A.J. Liebling on the fight between Rocky Marciano and Archie Moore. Brilliant piece of sports writing. So. But in this country, yeah, it was a battle. But I'm proud to say the Age has led the way, and it has it's had a tradition of creative writing in sport. And you could do things in sport you could never do in other parts of the paper. And Bob Brown said to me once, "I know what you're up to," because we were writing about Aboriginal stuff on the back page of the Age long before they were on the front, and raising issues about it. So. So yeah, sports writing's a, it's a great joy, yeah.
And so is reading your work, and we thank you very much for being here tonight and sharing the oration and the conversation, Martin Flanagan, everyone.
I'll take that.
And for all that hard work, a token of our appreciation, a nice bottle of red for you to enjoy after you've finished next week's column, or maybe after you've read tomorrow's column. Martin, thank you very much for being here. Thank you, everyone, for coming. It's our first event of the Sports Writers Festival. There's some books out the front that might be there for you to. And sportswritersfestival.com.au is the website. Tell your friends about us. We've got a whole program of events coming up over the weekend, including Brian Curtis tomorrow at the Town Hall talking about his experience writing in the United States for Grantland and The Ringer, and David Walsh on Tuesday talking about his experience writing about Lance Armstrong, and also a fantastic forum happening on Monday night about women's sport. You talked about it, women's AFL, the whole issue around women's sport, opportunity or opportunism, all of that stuff's on the website. Thanks for coming along. We'll be right back.
living, but on weekends comes the time. You can do whatever turns you on, go out and clear your mind. Me, I like football, there's a lot of things around. When you line them up together, the footy wins hands down. In there and fight, out there and Adam, show them your might. Up there, cause I need, don't let them in. Fly like an angel, you're out.